There are 8 million cop shows in the big city, but a cop show where the main detective loses her eyesight? I'm Bill Brio with the scoop on Sight Unseen. Welcome back. It's been a crazy few weeks here at the Brio Bunker. We sold our house and we're moving, and I'm even more lost than usual in terms of where everything is. We shall soldier on, however. The next voice you'll hear is that of Sight Unseen co-creator Nikolijne Troubetzkoy, who was first on the Zoom meeting call ahead of her sister Karen Troubetzkoy.
So Bill was telling us he just sold his house.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks very much, Kat. You've joined on.
Yeah, sorry. No. That's an exciting life change.
It is, mm-hmm. Yeah. Heading to Orangeville, Ontario.
Oh, so, my God. That's a lovely town.
Yeah. Looking forward to it. Family has a cottage north on Lake Huron, so it'll be a bit closer to get back and forth. And, you know, just looking to slow it down a bit. It's had enough of the traffic here in Brampton. So,
yeah.
Looking forward to it. Well, let me get this thing going. Your time is valuable. Congratulations on Sight Unseen. Just to let people know, this follows the adventures of Tess Avery, played by Dolly Lewis, a top homicide detective forced to quit her job after being diagnosed as clinically blind. Haunted by cases she left behind, she turns to an assistant app to connect with a professional seeing eye guide 3,000 miles away in New York City. It's a great, great premise, very unique and original. And joining me today are the co-creators of the series, sisters Karen Troubetzkoy and Nikki Troubetzkoy. Am I pronouncing your last name correctly?
You are.
Oh,
perfectly. But Nikolijne is Nikolijne with a silent J. also known as Niko, which is simpler. Niko.
I took a run at Nikolijne's name earlier with Nikolijne, and we both agreed Niko is probably the best idea for me to go with. So we'll stick with that. Listen, congratulations on this show. I really, really enjoyed the pilot and also all your other work. You guys both have worked on some great shows, Orphan Black, Killjoy, Sky Med, Transplant. So hats off to both of you. It's a miracle to make any show in Canada. You're on to your fifth great one. So good for you guys.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's a pleasure.
Now, Kat, let me start with you. The series, I understand, was inspired by your own experiences with sight loss. Is that correct?
Yes. This happened when I was in my 20s, and a lot of people who've worked with me don't know about it unless I show them the band around my eye, which is still in there. Mm. But I went through a very, very sudden sight loss event in my 20s after a night of dancing, slam dancing at the time, woke up with what I thought was a massive headache that had taken away half my vision. Half of it was just blackness. And I went to see a doctor immediately, just an ophthalmologist, and he said, "Don't move." I'm like, that's the strangest thing for an ophthalmologist to tell you. He said, "Not move. Take this seriously. I'm calling a hospital." And I was whisked into emergency surgery on both my eyes. And within, I think it was a multiple hour surgery, very complicated for one eye and a different thing for another. But I woke up with my eyes bandaged, and both my divorced parents, both of them, their voices at my bedside. And at the time, not knowing what would happen when the bandages were removed, it was a really terrifying and cathartic experience. And it, you know, the bandages came off. I could see a little, very much like Tess vision. In fact, if you've seen the pilot, just shadows and light, very deformed vision, less than that to begin with, but I slowly got up to Tess vision, I guess, in a few weeks. And ultimately, my vision was restored. I have periodic multiple surgeries, but they're laser, and I can see, but I have eye events. So all of that kind of inspired the idea for the show, along with Niko can explain the other element, which is the fucked up element of sunny.
Yeah, the other element is the tech that brings these two characters together. And Kat and I were both listening to a radio show, and there was a story about a woman with sight loss who was using the tech that we use in the show, which is basically people use it on their phones, but it's essentially a camera and a phone connection and an earpiece that links somebody with sight loss to a guide. So we listened as we heard this woman use her guide to help her get dressed, help her, go downstairs from her apartment building, get in an Uber, get out on the other side, come up to the radio studio. And as she was in the elevator, there was this amazing moment between the two of them where the woman with sight loss turns and looks in the mirrored wall of the elevator. And all of a sudden the guide sees her there and sees what she looks like rather than seeing her clothing or the Uber and all the things she's been guiding her along. And it was really revelatory. And we both are always trying to think up, you know, it's the universal writer's quest to find the new great idea for a procedural. And we both instantly thought, oh my God, this relationship that links these two people is so interesting and so complicated and so dependent on both sides. And we just thought that would be a really fascinating idea to bring two characters together in a show.
It's a great idea. And then the other wrinkle is that Sunny's character has agoraphobia, right? She's in her apartment in Manhattan, I presume, in New York City. And so she really can't get out, and Tess can't really see. So it's a fascinating combination and quite a good idea.
They're definitely both using each other. And Sunny is using Tess as a kind of avatar to get out in the world and to see things and to get into some pretty dangerous situations with which Sunny sees and feels, but Tess is the one whose life is on the line. So there's a lot of tension in that dichotomy.
And that really plays effectively for the viewers. I watched the pilot and the last 10 minutes, oh my goodness, it's scary. Because Tess is walking in literally into a dark building, and she does this throughout the show. Not so much of a handicap for her, but for the viewer, you're terrified. You don't know what's there. And then Sunny can see it, but she's not really there. And she's like holding her breath because she can see it. And that is a great combination. It really worked well.
Well, we wanted to throw the viewer right into the point of view of our two co-leads. So they are right in Sunny's camera. They are living the event as though they are Tess, because it is almost like a first-person shooter game or one of those immersive online games. So you are Tess for those moments, which is an interesting and fresh POV. And we have also got the wonderful and talented John Fawcett, who co-created Orphan Black, to thank for the tension that he can wring out of every scene that he shoots. So John Fawcett really brought that thriller element to it. And as soon as he read the pilot, he said, this is a really great detective thriller. And we loved the notion of a detective thriller rather than just a procedural. So hopefully.
It is. It's exactly that. I know John, and he's very talented. So congrats there. I should say I have glaucoma. And when I read your premise, I was fascinated. I was down in L.A. on a press tour and didn't realize that the pressure was building up on one eye. And by the time I got back, a lot of damage was done. So I only have about a third of my eyesight in one eye. What works for me, where I'm very fortunate, what I learned is that when you have one functioning eye, it kind of fills in. I don't really feel anything, you know, there's probably some peripheral here, but so far so good, knock wood. Shout out to the folks at Prism in Mississauga there, Oakville, Brampton, Dr. Klein, who it's remarkable what they can do these days. Really tremendous in terms of eye surgery and everything else. But so I was fascinated to see how you would depict this point of view. And you must have experimented with different looks. I know you have consultants who have helped you on this. It sort of looks like almost a macular degeneration in the middle and then very fuzzy around. But how did you come up with that look?
We did this in collaboration with our cinematographer and also a kind of a combination of experiences. It is not absolutely accurate of LHRON, LHRON, Leber's hereditary neuropathy. But it is, for myself, I have a combination of eye events that happen. So I have extreme floaters due to all the surgeries and the laser surgeries. And so I have experiences much like that where shapes are floating through and there's lines of light. We wanted the experience to be viewable for the audience who is sighted, but also reflect like multiple sight impairment POVs. So it is an amalgamation of vision loss and the cinematographer's vision for the show. So,
yeah.
And it's going to evolve just like people's eyes evolve, you know, as we go. It's not always identical because sight loss, it depends on the light hitting. Sometimes light sensitivity happens and sometimes the darkness happens. So we're trying to reflect all that and also make a beautiful show for those who are sighted. So,
Shooting in Vancouver helps in that last idea too. It's a beautiful city, right?
Yeah, we're really lucky to get to shoot there. Amazing. Kat, we're half sisters, so we grew up separately. Kat grew up there, but I'd never really spent time out there or shot out there. And great crews, amazing locations. It's really a fabulous, great guest stars. You know, It's a fantastic place.
And our producers on the ground, Front Street, made us feel so at home and welcome. And shout out to Front Street.
Yeah. They're great. Give me one second. I mentioned to Niko that we've just sold our house. I have to open my door. I'll be right back, okay?
Oh, that's exciting.
We'll be back with Niko and Karen in just a moment. Time once again to check in with our friend Emily Gagne at Hollywood Suite. Emily, Happy New Year. What do you got for us now?
Well, Bill, we're blasting off into 2024 with genre fair. We're talking sci-fi, we're talking horror, we're talking the freakiest and the most fun movies you can think of. Everything from Beetlejuice to Blade we've got on our channels this month.
Wow, Blade scares me. What's the freakiest sci-fi film you've got, though?
Sci-fi, I mean, we've got 2001 A Space Odyssey. I don't know if that's the freakiest, but it's a classic. We've got Close Encounters of the Third Kind. But I really think if you want something weird and wonderful, we have this film called 976 Evil, which is directed by Freddy Krueger himself, Robert Englund.
Well, that's the number, 976 Evil. You can find it on Hollywood Suite. Emily, thanks for the tip.
Thanks, Bill.
Back with more on Sight Unseen.
Hey there again. Sorry about that.
The stagers are here to take back the furniture that they staged in our house. So this place, you might see the books moving away as we're talking. It's a busy day. Anyway, Dolly, now let's just talk about Dolly Lewis. My God, she's come from nowhere. She plays Tess Avery. Where did you find her?
Niko, do you want to talk about that search? Quite the search.
It was quite the search. So we really wanted to cast somebody who had experience with sight loss as Tess. We did a really big search in Canada first to look for that actor. Did not, unfortunately, end up finding the right person for the role in Canada. And so then we continued to search. We looked in the US, we looked in the UK, we looked in Australia, we looked in New Zealand, parts of Europe, used multiple casting agencies, did chemistry tests, and it took months and months and finally came down to a couple of candidates. And then Dolly was just like a last minute addition to the pool who came out of nowhere. Somebody had seen her read for another role and knew she had sight loss and passed her on to us. And she ended up being the perfect fit for the role and just turned out fantastically.
Yeah, no, she's very effective, very different look, and congrats. Yeah, I think she fits really well. Kat, did you offer her any tips or coaching in terms of her performance?
We offered her, and she took. She's someone who loves to learn. Like, I have just like an open book. So she was with our original consultant. We've always had Yvonne Felix working with us, who is a sight impaired technology and, well, she's an artist, and she works in the interface between technology and visual impairment for big companies like Google and so on. And she's worked for the Canadian National Institute for the Blind and many other fields. So she took Dolly, and they spent days, I think, talking on Zoom. And Yvonne has been across her performances and across the show and across every script, every outline, and even in post and at the mixes. Yvonne Felix is absolutely central to this show for us. So Dolly spent time with her, as well as Amy's beautiful last name. I can never, Niko.
Amantia.
A beautiful name, who was on set helping Dolly with the movements and with the cane work that she later does in later episodes. She sometimes uses a cane. And also with our guide dog, who works with Mia, a character, Mia. And then Dolly also trained with a police detective, an undercover police detective, who is incredible, who took her through kind of boot camp training so that she could learn how to be a strong police officer, hold a gun, do all that. And then Dolly has her own sight impairment to fall back on, and she did not use any of her corrective lenses. So on set and so on, you know, it was very startling, but she couldn't really see. Like, so if she'd come up to you on set, you had to identify yourself. And then she would get so close that she would almost be touching your nose and go, "Oh, hi, Kat, it's you." So she put herself through the rigors by just not using corrective lenses or anything while she was performing. And Niko, I'm forgetting something. The police, the undercover officer, we're not allowed to talk about by any kind of name or identifying feature, who is used to be able to see and lost his vision and is still working in the police force to this day in a department we're not allowed to discuss. They bonded and talked about that experience as well. So she's really, really, immersed herself.
Yeah, no, I didn't realize that she had her own sight issues. My goodness, it's fascinating. You know, it's such a visual medium to have the creator and the star have a sight, you know, issue like this. Do you find that you listen more to the shows? You know, like, do your other senses perk up as a producer?
Yes. We haven't talked about this much, and we are doing post, and we're doing it quickly because the show's rolling out. Mm. But we are really doing sound in fresh ways. We are trying to do Foley in a kind of extra crisp way. We are creating little hollows out of silence where we can, and we're really paying attention to the sound more and more as we go through the episodes. Following Tess's journey, at first she's just suddenly blind, so she's not learning to use those senses. And it's very important to say that sight loss does not make for super hearing or super other senses.
Right, right.
But it does make you pay attention to different things. And we're just trying to pay attention to sound in a different way in our show, learning curve for us and everybody. But yeah.
I also, it's fascinating, the show changes tone here and there. There's some very funny moments. yet it works, you know, like sometimes that can be jarring, but you manage to make the pilot at least make it very effective. Sunny's character in particular, she's pretty hilarious at times. But even Dolly, you know, there's a scene, she's in bed with some guy at the beginning, and that is a very, very sexy and very funny scene, because that's when she decides to try out this app that looks for her, and a couple of male voices come. I shouldn't be saying watch the show, but I don't think
that'll stop people from watching.
No. I think you're right. It probably helped, but I love that it had that tone, and then the actors were all really able to go there. That must have been important to you when you were casting and making it.
Yeah. It was that we had a couple of writers in the writing room, Ryan Knighton, who describes himself as blind, who is he's written a bunch of amazing novels. His first one is called Cockeyed, and he works as a TV writer for big shows like Billions, but he's Canadian. And a guy called Graham Isidore, who's a very well-known playwright. And one of the most interesting things I think that they brought to the room and to the show was just how, you know, they both seem to have a bit of a blackly humorous take on what life is like when you start to lose your sight and the situations that puts you into. And we really wanted to give Tess's experience and her relationship with Sunny like a real full experience. And we see that humor as very much part of it.
And it was great to have these two sight impaired writers give us permission to be funny on that front. But what is really absurd is that this one lady is inside the other one's head and steering her remotely. And it's kind of like, who has control of the body and who, where do you draw that line? That's scary. That's thrilling, but it's also funny and absurd. So we tried to walk that tightrope.
It's fantastic. And does this exist, these surrogate eyes apps? Yes. Is that a real thing?
Yes. Oh, 100%. I mean, some of our writers with sight loss use them. There are a couple of different ones. There's paid versions. There's volunteer versions. But they absolutely exist.
Yeah, Ira with an A is the big paid one, A-I-R-A, if you're interested in looking it up. And then the big volunteer one, which is an international worldwide network, you just phone and a volunteer will see for you through your camera phone, is called, is it Be My Eyes?
Be My Eyes, yeah.
Wow.
My Eyes
is a big bomb. Yeah,
I'm sorry, didn't mean to interrupt you. Go ahead.
Oh, it's just kind of beautiful, the fact that there's a worldwide volunteer organization as well as the paid choice. And there's a lot to be said for both, right? Judges and lawyers tend to use the paid people because they sign NDAs.
That's true. Everybody would need it. So that is fantastic. The only place I've ever sort of seen it in a film or movie is Melissa McCarthy did a comedy, Spies, a while ago, where they had something like this. And
that was one of our big inspirations Spy. Such a great movie.
We hadn't seen it when we came up with the idea. And when we saw it, we were just like, oh, my God, this really can work.
you can see it a bit in the Agam's performance. I think it's there, right? She's got that same glint in her eye. It's pretty funny. Obviously, you had to also study agoraphobia to make this real as well, right? Did you get some information there?
Yeah, we did. Go ahead, Kat.
It's usually caused by PTSD, and we did a lot of reading on it. If I was to say an inspirational movie, it might be Kimmy by Sondheim. Mm-hmm. I'm just someone who doesn't like to leave the house much, and I think I'm one of those people who enjoyed a little bit the lockdowns. I'm sorry. I mean, there are people who are very shy and introverted.
I understand. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think that the lockdowns, also just being in one's house, was something we identified at the time. We did some psychological research just on paper.
back after this brief message. Well, did you know that it was June Carter Cash who wrote one of Johnny Cash's biggest hits, Ring of Fire? That's just one of the things you'll learn watching June, streaming this month on Paramount Plus. June shines a spotlight on the history of country music and the Carter and Cash families. The five-time Grammy Award-winning singer, actor, and author has opened for Elvis, appeared on screen with Robert Duvall and Jane Seymour, and as mentioned, was a damn fine songwriter. Featuring interviews with the woman herself, the film also includes sit-downs with her family, admirers, and friends, including Dolly Parton, Reese Witherspoon, and Willie Nelson. And remember, there's a mountain of premium entertainment for audiences of all ages on Paramount Plus. The second season of the compelling crime thriller Hidden Assets returns to Super Channel for its exclusive Canadian premiere on Sunday, February 11th at 9 p.m., with each episode also available on Super Channel On Demand. This Irish-Belgian-Canadian co-production is a must-watch for aficionados of crime thrillers. In season two of this Super Channel original, Criminal Asset Bureau's new team lead, Claire Wallace, finds herself at odds with CTU's Christian De Jong over the Antwerp investigation. And speaking of hidden assets, Quebecer and Brio TV favorite Karine Vanesse is among the Canadians on season two of this drama. And remember, Super Channel, an all-Canadian service, is available via most cable providers across the country, as well as streaming live and on demand with Amazon Prime Video channels, Apple TV Plus, and the Roku platform in Canada. Here they are again, series creators Niko and Karen Troubetzkoy. The other cast members are terrific too. I've had Roger Cross on as a podcast guest, and he's a great actor, and it was good to see him in the pilot. Ennis Esmer as well. I see you got him coming up. How did you, Vancouver does have a deep pool of talent. Is that where you drew most of the people from?
Most of them. We're really lucky. Ennis is Toronto based, but he blew it out of the water. He plays, can I say who he plays, Kat? Is that a spoiler?
Yeah, we could just say that Sunny can't see many people, and he's her concierge.
Yeah.
And it goes from there. It's a very pivotal role. And he really surprised us, even though I've worked with him before. He's always a revelation. And also he does some, don't let him hear this. He does some pretty good ad-libs.
Yes, he does.
And then Roger Cross made everyone laugh. Like, oh my God, he's the funniest guy when the camera's not rolling.
Mm, yeah.
Oh, he's wonderful.
He's phenomenal on screen. Like he just, every scene he's in, just absolutely fantastic. He takes it to another level.
Yeah, no, they're all very good actors. So what does it mean? Your show is also, it's on the CW as well, right? Is it?
Yes.
Yeah. That must be important for you to get that exposure in the States.
Yeah, we haven't started airing on the CW yet, so that'll happen in spring, but it's fantastic to get that exposure, and they were on through the whole writing room process, and they were really great partners through it as well, and really gave us some great feedback, and were wonderful to work with.
Yeah. I apologize. I've only seen the pilot so far, but I'm really looking forward to seeing more. But the character Tess, she doesn't tell anyone that she's can't see that, or she has a, is this something that she has to clear up fairly quickly in the series, or does she try not to give away this throughout the first season?
if the story evolves, I mean, her character evolves. So we solve a case every week, but her character and her decisions evolve over time. We were really initially interested in the fact that sight impairment is an invisible disability. And then you put this app on it and it is absolutely, you know, she just walks among everyone with her disability unseen, which is part of the sight unseen. And she has someone else watching for her, also unseen. That's where the title comes from. But she does begin to disclose gradually to certain people. And that's part of the evolution of season one.
And did you say you've actually used this app, one of these apps?
I personally haven't used one of those apps. When I lost my sight, they weren't around. And I just get by and I can see at the moment. But some of our sight impaired writers do use them. Like I will just say Graham Isidore uses them. He's sorry for the noise. Graham Isidore uses them. When he's at the airport, it's like there are places where you just need to be able to see and you're not going to be grabbing someone next to you. You just need someone to explain what you're seeing, where your gate is, et cetera. So he uses them on and off.
I just wonder how, like literally in the show, you know, walk 8 paces, turn left, ignore, you know, shake this guy's hand. Like it seems amazing if it works, but you know, it would be fascinating to try and do that. Well, you know, again, let's tell people it's going to be premiering on CTV this Sunday, I believe, on the 21st of January. And then you have a regular night where it's airing. What night of the week will it be after that?
Mondays at 10 p.m.
Mondays at 10 p.m. Pretty good time slot. Sight Unseen, how long did it take to come up with the title?
There's lots of stories behind the title, but it is the original title we came up with. We flirted with a strange title for a while, just privately. Speed of Light. That was when we were being overly intellectual. Speed of Light. Thank God clear heads prevailed.
Well, you know, Schitt's Creek got on the air, so I guess go for your original title, right? That's always good advice. Now, I got a couple of questions here beyond your show, which I urge people to check out. It's tremendous. And just the idea of finding and pushing yourselves into an area, the cop format is so prevalent in TV, but to find these original hooks as creators, as writers, it must be a bit thrilling because you've opened a whole new box, haven't you?
Yeah. I think we have. And it was fascinating, the whole process of writing it and then filming it was really fascinating because it wasn't really until we saw the first editor's assembly of a scene between Tess and Sunny put together that we really had proof of concept, you know, because we're filming them separately, we're writing these scripts, and then we're casting them. You know, we did rehearsals, but then finally seeing a scene cut together was like, oh my God, this work, this is original and it works and it makes for a really cool show.
Yeah. And I'm sure it's the same experience for the directors and others involved to portray that. Now, I have some questions for the two of you. Just what are you watching now? Is there something that TV show that you just are loving at the moment that you're streaming?
For me, it's Slow Horses. I just love Slow Horses.
Absolutely. Yeah. What a great show. Good choice. God. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if your sight is limited in some ways, you know, you don't probably waste your time looking at junk, right? Do you find you're more discriminating as a viewer, Kat?
I like funny shit and dumb shit too. So right. No, I like a laugh. But right now, yeah, Slow Horses is beautiful, dark and funny. And say something like The Bear, you know, it's a different smorgasbord every time. So I love that. But I like silly stuff too.
All right. Niko, what are you watching?
I'm a little behind the times, but I'm watching The Morning Show, which I am just completely captivated by. Mm-hmm. It, like, fantastic writing. cinematography, music, everything is really, really top notch.
It's amazing what you can do for $10 million an episode.
I know. I dream of having that kind of money to spend one day.
Yeah, they managed to scrape together a story. I think the guys on that show are pretty amazing, especially the first season. Their names are escaping me at the moment. When you guys were growing up, was there a show that you just loved that you would race home from school or you just couldn't get enough of?
Well, we grew up separately and we both had one experience in common that our parents didn't get us TVs until we were older. So there was that. So TV was the forbidden fruit, hence our careers. Wow. But for me, I would say I discovered TV at my friends' houses, and it was MASH, which was probably in the darker years of MASH by the time I discovered it. But that was that blew me away.
Did you catch the MASH documentary on January 1st on Fox? They did a 2-hour salute to MASH. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I will be catching that. That sounds fantastic.
Must be some way to stream it or find it. But yeah, it was on the Fox January 1st and it was well made. It was very chronological, but check that out if you're a fan. Yeah.
Oh, great. Thank you.
Niko, what did you watch growing up?
And for me, it was my mom, when I was in high school, she finally got like a little tiny black and white TV that got three channels over the air. Which I wasn't allowed to watch, but on Friday nights we would settle down in bed with a beer. I was allowed to have a beer and some blue corn chips and watch Dallas, which I just loved. I thought it was bee's knees.
A lot of people are rewatching Dallas. I know quite a few people are really, really into the old Dallas series now, but I find that fascinating. So your mom wouldn't let you watch television, but beer is okay, is what you're telling me.
Yeah, she's European, you know? She's got her party.
That's amazing. So parents, if you want your children to grow up to be TV creators, don't let them watch television, as sort of seems to be the secret. Who knew? Do either of you have a favorite all-time TV theme song?
Oh, I love The Wire, the Tom Waits song, Down in the Hole. I'm a huge Tom Waits fan, and I just think that was a fabulous theme song.
Pretty good series, too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mine was always the Deadwood steel guitar. I love that haunting strain. But unfortunately, Slow Horses, Mick Jagger, I just play it on repeat. There's a longer version. If you haven't heard that, go to Google.
Was Graham Yost involved in Deadwood as well?
I'm not sure.
No, that was David Milch, right?
So probably it was. Yeah. Malcolm McCurry, who's a Canadian TV writer, I think he wrote on Deadwood.
Yes. So many damn talented Canadians. It's ridiculous.
I know.
Yeah. Well, listen, congratulations. Sight Unseen is coming up Sunday and then watch it on Mondays. It's a wonderful, fresh approach on a cop show. Great acting and writing. Both of you, congratulations. Thank you for taking the time to talk to me today.
Thanks very much. It was a pleasure.
All right. Take care.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye. Well, the Troubetzkoys both picked unusual TV themes as their all-time favorites, so let's try to hear a few seconds of each. Niko went with a theme from The Wire, and Kat chose the theme from Deadwood. Two of the best TV shows from this century or any century. See if you can tell which is which. Okay, well, I made mention of the Prism Eye Institute in Brampton and Oakville, Ontario. The doctors and surgeons associated with this place are tops. They're very, very busy, though. I tell Dr. Klein every time I see him, and thanks to him I can see him, that he should get a new business card printed up. It should say, Dr. Thomas Klein, a hard man to see. Another guy who does great work every time is producer Phil Hong, who accepts and transforms everything I send him sight unseen. Thanks to the CTV publicity department for setting up the interviews for this episode. Thanks as always to BJ Del Conte, the Crispy Critters, and Steve Dudley for the music used on this podcast. Special thanks to you for listening, and please spread the word if you liked what you heard. I'm Bill Brio. Thanks for listening.